Director of Study Abroad at Winona State University, and I, along with my colleague Katie Subra, who you'll meet a little bit later, are the co-chairs for this year's university theme, Our Global Identity, Our Global Community. We're very excited to welcome Christian Vizl virtually to our campus to speak today, and you'll have the opportunity to enjoy his beautiful photography and also listen to his important message that will surely stimulate how we think about our global connections. I'd like to take just a few minutes to talk about the university theme. The pandemic we are currently in the midst of certainly gives us many new angles to reflect on our position and our identity in the world. The theme, Our Global Identity, Our Global Community, invites you to explore and consider the many different aspects of identity within ourselves, our community, and our world. Through the theme events, we ask you to reflect and consider questions such as, what is my global identity? Where are my global connections? And what new global connections await me in the future? A list of theme-related events and activities is located on the theme website, as well as on our theme Facebook page. The links are listed at the top of this slide. Please check back frequently because the year is young and events will be added throughout the year. I'd like to acknowledge and thank our co-sponsors. First of all, the Minnesota Marine Art Museum, who reached out to partner with us and is currently displaying Christian's art at their museum. Winona State University, who provides funding for theme-related events and activities throughout the year. And also the WSU Student Green Fees that supported the Green Fee Project Grant, which we were awarded to help fund this event. We'd also like to give a special thanks to the university's Learning and Engagement Committee, Professor Ma's design students who produced our beautiful theme logo and promotional designs. And finally, a huge thank you to all of the many faculty, staff, and students that are serving on the theme team. And they lend so much of their time and talent to help plan and coordinate all the events and activities we planned throughout last year and now are actually implementing this year. All right, now on to our giveaway. So with the Green Fee Project grant that we received, we were able to purchase 50 bracelets through the company 4Ocean. Each bracelet purchase funds the removal of 1 pound of trash from our oceans, rivers, and coastlines. So the first 50 people who email their name to studyabroad@winona.edu will win one of these bracelets. So send your emails now. And if you are one of the lucky first 50 people, you receive an email with details on how you can pick up your bracelet. So quickly, go ahead and email. And now finally, a few housekeeping items. So for the best view of the presentation, you'll want to click the speaker view in the upper right-hand corner of your screen. This will allow you to see Christian's presentation on his screen and then as well as see him actually speaking. Questions can be entered in the Q&A function located at the bottom of your screen throughout the presentation. However, we will answer all of the questions at the end. And students, if you would like to receive co-curricular credit for attending the presentation, please email your name to Katie Subra at ksubra@winona.edu, and Katie will make sure that registrar receives the requests. And finally, please complete a survey after the presentation to give us your feedback. We'll throw that link in the Q&A at the end of the presentation as well. And with that, I will hand it over to Dave Casey from the Marine Art Museum.
Thank you, Susan. My name is Dave Casey. I'm Assistant Curator of Education and Exhibitions here at the Minnesota Marine Art Museum. I'd like to share a little bit about the museum for those of you that have not been here before. We're located here in Winona. We're a fine art museum that engages visitors in meaningful visual art experiences through education and exhibitions that explore the ongoing and historic human relationship with water. We have three galleries here in the museum that highlight our collection of historic European and American artworks, which feature the likes of Picasso, Monet, O'Keeffe, Audubon, among many others, all focused around the theme of great art inspired by water. On top of our permanent collection, we have three galleries of temporary exhibitions, which frequently highlight contemporary artists, such as Christian's work, also exploring our relationship with water. Christian's exhibition, Silent Kingdom, opens today at the Minnesota Marine Art Museum. and runs through January 3rd, 2021. So I encourage you to come out and check out the exhibition while it's here. And I'd like to remind all the students attending that our admission is free for all students on every Tuesday. So come on a Tuesday, you can see it for free. For those of you that cannot make it to the museum or are uncomfortable going out right now, I understand. We do have an online exhibition available on our website featuring the images and most of the text from the exhibition, so you can check that out as well. Before I get started, I want to introduce, Christian, I'd like to thank a couple people. First of all, Winona State, Susan and Katie, thank you for all the work you've done with their theme 2020. Their 2020 theme of My Global Identity, Our Global Community. I'd like to thank them for partnering with us on this presentation. Secondly, I'd like to thank, thanks to the generous support of Ernest and Sally Mysak, we can provide free adult lecture series at the Minnesota Marine Art Museum. And lastly, very important, I'd like to thank Cindy and Leroy Telsted, who are the exclusive exhibition sponsors for the exhibition Silent Kingdom. And of course, I'd like to thank Christian Vizl for being with us today via Zoom. When this exhibition was planned a long time ago, we intended for Christian to fly up to Minnesota to be here for the opening today and to speak, but obviously it's impossible right now. It's kind of 50 degrees and raining here, Christian, right now, so you're probably better off in Mexico than being in Minnesota right now anyway. A quick introduction for Christian. He was born in Mexico City and has been a photographer for over three decades. He's won dozens of international photography awards, including Wildlife Photographer of the Year, International Photographer of the Year, Sony World Photography Awards, and World Photography Cup. He has served as a judge in several international underwater photography contests, and his images can be seen published in numerous outlets, including National Geographic and Ocean Geographic. His photographs are not only beautiful, but they come with a powerful message about conservation, that the future of mankind is connected to the health of our oceans. With that, I'd like to hand it over to you, Christian.
Thank you very much, Dave, and Susan, and Katie, and John, who is not with us right now, but also with the museum. And I'd like to thank you, really, all of the team working in the museum and in the Winona State University. For me, it's an absolute pleasure and honor, because today it's the inauguration of my exhibition over there, which is one of the highlights in my career. It's what any photographer would aspire, to be shown my work in such a beautiful and amazing museum, and also to be able to speak to the students of the Winona State University, to send my message in a more direct and personal way, which is always also one of the highlights of the things that I do in my life. And so thank you very much. Thank you for all the participants who already joined us, and hope you enjoyed this presentation. I'm gonna start with a video, and I'll come back after the video. Thank you.
El océano, un lugar lleno de belleza. Los animales coexisten en un perfecto estado de balance y armonía que la naturaleza tardó millones de años en perfeccionar. Todas las formas de vida en este planeta, incluyéndonos a los seres humanos, dependemos completamente de la salud del mar. Ya sea que vivas en las montañas o en medio de una gran ciudad, el mar llega a ti. Llega a ti en cada respiro que das, en cada gota de agua que tomas y en cada alimento que consumes. El planeta Tierra y el mar, junto a todos sus animales, bosques, selvas, lagos y ríos, son nuestra fuente de vida, pero no son ilimitados. Los estamos destruyendo y pronto nos vamos a quedar sin nada cambia. Es momento de elevar nuestra conciencia, enfrentar nuestro ego, y dejar de pensar solamente en nuestro bienestar, para que así, desde el amor, nos reconectemos con la naturaleza entendiendo que si dañamos a otro ser vivo y a su ecosistema, nos estamos también dañando a nosotros mismos. Es hora de restablecer el equilibrio natural que hemos roto, haciéndonos responsables de nuestra participación en este estado actual de caos. No podemos ni debemos esperar a que gobiernos y empresas actúen. Para que ellas cambien, necesitamos cambiar cada uno de nosotros, ya que somos nosotros mismos los que alimentamos este sistema autodestructivo. Hemos perdido nuestra conexión con la naturaleza. Vivimos con una gran inconsciencia de tomar más de lo que hay y no damos nada a cambio. Nos está ganando el ego. Pensamos solo en nosotros mismos, en las cosas materiales que creemos necesitar y que deseamos obtener a toda costa, sin cuestionarnos las consecuencias, el sufrimiento ni la devastación que esto genera y que además nunca nos llena. Tenemos una gran tarea por delante. Podemos convertirnos en agentes de cambio y sumarnos a reconstruir este mundo que compartimos con todos los demás seres vivos. Se necesita de cada uno de nosotros y de cada una de nuestras acciones amorosas, desinteresadas y solidarias. No podemos amar y proteger aquello que no conocemos. Por eso mi intención con esta plática es que conozcas más a fondo el océano y la vida de los peces, con la esperanza de que los puedas ver como son y no como un simple recurso. Vamos a conocer nuestras terribles acciones que están matando al mar, con la esperanza de que al hacerlo nos empecemos a responsabilizar por nuestros propios actos y así, despiertos y con empatía hacia otras formas de vida, exploremos ideas y acciones que todos podemos empezar a hacer para que juntos cambiemos la devastadora realidad en la que hoy estamos viviendo antes de que sea demasiado tarde. ¿Te unes?
Well, I hope you have a... I hope you have enjoyed the video, the presentation. And well, let me first start by telling you how I ended up giving an ocean conservation talk. You might be wondering that. And many years ago, I was a diving instructor, and then I was also cave diving. And then many years later, and I have always loved the ocean since I was a little kid. So then later in my life, I started to do underwater photography, which is my passion and my whole world right now. And then I started to also learn about all the problems that we have created in the ocean. And then everything changed for me when I envisioned, when I saw, you know, completely the whole picture of the importance of nature for our lives and especially the ocean and what we are doing to it. Then, you know, my motivation and my everything changed inside of me and my intention. So now this is my goal, you know, to try to do something for the ocean and for the animals that live in the ocean, but also it's doing something for us because we depend on the life of the ocean. So why it's important to care about the health of the ocean? We need to ask us that very, very important and very basic question. And this is because our lives depend on it. It's as simple as that, because our own lives, everybody's life, and actually the entire life on this planet depends on the health of the ocean. Why? Because of many things, because it controls the weather all around the planet, because it regulates the temperature of the planet, it absorbs the excess CO2 that we are throwing into the atmosphere, contains 97% of the water and 97% of the biosphere in the entire planet. It also governs the chemistry of the planet. It returns the water to lakes and rivers, produces more than half of the oxygen that we breathe. Yes, just let's pause for a second just to think about that fact. Every other breath we take, it comes from the ocean. This is a knowledge that's relatively new to science. Before we thought that all the oxygen was produced by the trees, but now we know half comes from the ocean. And it is also the basis of the entire food chain. So, wow, the ocean is really important to our lives. And later on, you know, in my childhood dream, I forgot to tell you about the childhood dream that I had. And I was very fortunate that my parents, they love the ocean and they like being in the beach. So all my vacations when I was growing up, they were in the ocean and they took us camping in a beautiful place in the Mexican Pacific. And I remember as a little kid, you know, just sitting down in a deserted beach, and I used to dream, you know, like what would be like if suddenly all the water would just disappear, and then I could walk inside the ocean and see all the animals exactly where they were, you know, the fishes and the sharks. And that was like a dream. And not long ago, I read a book that explained all the fascinating facts about how they live their lives, and it's called The Secret Life of Fish. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about fishes. So did you know that all fish, they touch for pleasure? They include sharks and rays and mammals, all the animals in the ocean, they touch for pleasure, same as us. And they also enjoy the meals, the sex, and seek comfort for their well-being. They also feel pain, and this implies a conscious experience, which means they are sensible, they have experiences that take notes and have memory. That is to say, they are not merely alive, they have lives. So we are used to think about fishes, you know, as just being dumb and like robotic things, you know, and that they're just for our consumption and that they don't feel pain, you know. Now science has proved us wrong. They actually have very interesting lives. And they are, of course, beautiful individuals, because not all of the fish from the same species, they will act the same way. They are very different, even among the same species. They are very individual. And they have feelings and different personalities and complex behaviors that science is actually only starting to understand. And they have emotions, they have fear, they can relax, they can stress, they are vulnerable to depression and anxiety, and they can socially learn by observing others. They play for fun and are curious, so pretty amazing lives. They are intelligent and they are capable of cognitive feats like cartography. Yes, some gobies, when the tide goes high, you know, a lot of puddles are created when the water recedes, and then the gobies, they make mental maps. They can predict, you know, they know already that the tide is gonna go low, and when the tide go low, they're gonna be only puddles. So they make these mental maps of all the puddles. So when they are stuck in one, if there is a predator in that puddle, what they will do, they will jump to the nearest puddle around them to evade the predator. So that's pretty amazing. And they learn many different ways. They innovate to solve problems. They use tools. They are flexible and curious, and they try new strategies to solve problems, which is amazing. Very, very few live alone. And they are social, and their societies reveal how amazing their lives are. When they swim in a reef, they choose whom to swim with, and they favor the company of their own species when others are present. And they cooperate among themselves and create strong bonds for roles such as mating, breeding, cooperation, and security. So, like the picture you're looking right now, they don't swim randomly in a school of fish. They actually tend to prefer and favor the company of certain individuals that they get along. Same as you guys, you know, walking in your campus, in the university, you know, you tend to stick together to certain people, you know, that you like better. So fish also do that. Amazing. So They are individuals, meaning individual fish have individual personalities. As I said before, they don't behave exactly the same. They have very different behaviors. Like you can be diving with a, maybe there are a couple of snappers around, and maybe one of them, he will be curious enough to come close to you, you know, and maybe establish some kind of communication, or maybe, you know, play with you or whatever. And his friend who was swimming with him, he might not approach you. He might just stay there because he can be a little bit more shy, you know. So kind of different personalities, which is amazing. And there is this example, which is the most sophisticated form of interaction in fishes. And this is the creation of long-time social contracts. And most notably, it is the symbiosis between the cleaner and client, one of the most complex and sophisticated social systems of any animal. And they are so important that they can have a huge effect in the species diversity of a reef. So all the animals in the ocean, all of them, even sharks and dangerous ones, or apparently dangerous ones, they need to be cleaned from parasites. And there are a lot of different species from cleaning fishes. So they need to get in touch, and they need to do like a social contract, because most of the time, or some of the fishes that they will clean, they can eat them, you know. So they have first to establish some security rules, you know, that, okay, I'm not going to eat you right now. So the shark might come to a reef and signal with a body position that he wants to be clean, not to eat. And then the clean fish will come close to him, and then they will start to clean, okay? But there is a very interesting thing that if they take a big bite out of the fish, they will get more food for the fish, so it's more beneficial, but it will hurt a little bit, you know, whoever he's been cleaning. So they can remember up to 300 different clients that they will have every day, because they need to be clean every day, or very usually, okay? So he will know if a fish is coming to him for the first time to be clean. So if it's a new client, he will be very careful and will just take a little bit, just a, you know, a bite, so it doesn't hurt the fish, the cleaning fish. So he will be willing to come back the next day, okay? Because then he will know that he's already his client, and then, you know, they won't waste a lot of time to take to this social contract, you know? So it's very, very interesting. And this is the best example of the intelligence of fish. They need to have a lot of conditions, you know, and a lot of cognitive possibilities to be able to do this behavior. And of course, not all of the fish are equally intelligent, but in one recent study, one species performed better than a four-year-old human and better than some apes. This is an example of another animal cleaning a fish, which is a shrimp. And this is another example. It's a beautiful turtle. Again, these turtles, they signal to the fish with the body, this position, that they are ready to be clean, and then fish approach to clean them. Fascinating. But sadly, it's not easy being a fish in the human era, because we keep eating more and more fish, even when the populations are dramatically falling down. So, in my opinion, fish are not a resource, a product, or tons of food to fulfill our needs, but reality is very different. All the fishes that we consume are killed in very horrible ways. One net alone can have a 500,000 fish, and they are crushed by the weight of others. And the ones that survive will die of suffocation. The ones caught with long lines will suffer impalement for hours or days, only to eventually die of suffocation. Our creativity to kill is infinite. And the ones that live in the deep, they face other dangers, like decompression injuries, esophageal aversion. That's when the esophagus comes out of their mouths. Anybody who is a sport fisherman will tell you that, you know. or exothermia, which is ice coming out of the orbits because of the change in pressures. They also are prone to arterial and renal embolism, hemorrhage, torsion of organs, damage or displaced organs, etc. Sport fishing, it still has a benign place in our culture, but only in the United States there are more than 33 million people engaging in this activity, and 10% of the world population fish regularly. That's about roughly 700 million fishes killed regularly in ways they suffer a lot. So catch and release, the hooks, they damage the facial tissues, and eye damages are very frequent. The maneuver to release is very hard on the fishes. They damage the protective mucus layer and leaves them very vulnerable to diseases. So after all, more than 33% of them dies after being released. So that's a view of what we are doing to fish. And let me show you another video that I hope you will see the animals in a different perspective once you know what you now know, after what I just said. So can we put, please, the presentation, another video? Okay, hope you enjoyed that video. It took me, I found that event in, actually right in front of where I'm some years ago, and I'm not a filmmaker, but I just did this short video and from the whole event, and it was just about a couple of hours of being underwater, and this, you know, such an amazing amount of life and the way they interact. So I learn a lot every time I go down there. I learn a lot from the animals. I would like to talk to you more about that, but maybe later. Because now we need to go into the hardest part of this presentation, and please stay with me. I know it's gonna be a little bit depressing. Now we're gonna, I'm gonna tell you about the problems that we have created, and I'm not inventing them. This is just what all the scientists are telling us for many years now. So it's important that we know them, but it's more important that we go to the final phase of this presentation, which is what can we do about it, okay? So bear with me doing this. So, as we have seen, the sea gives us life, no? What would do we give the sea in return? So today the ocean is in grave danger. The problems generated by us is threatening the fundamental nature of the ocean, and we are pushing its animals to their extinction. We are more informed of the problems we have created on land, but the majority of us are unaware that without the blue, there could be no green. The ocean is the key to all life on Earth. So let's take a look at the problems we are creating. First, overfishing. And this is why I start my presentation talking about fish, because, and this is why I defend fish, because there is a study that was published in 2006 by the United Nations, and it stated that if we continue at the same rate of consumption of animals from the ocean, by 2048, all life on the sea could disappear. Now, that's 2048, and recently they revised the study, and because our rate of consumption is ever increasing, we consume more and more and more animals from the ocean. Now, the deadline is 2040, so it's just around the corner. We are actually in the sixth mass extinction right now, and it's created by us, where extinction rate is 1,000 times bigger than before humans. Worldwide Fund says that that 10,000 animals will extinguish every year. 10,000 species, I'm sorry. Well, the worst method of fishing is trawling, and there are many more, but today fishing is not limited by how many we can catch, but by how many they are actually left in the ocean. So it's time to realize that the problem is not overfishing, the problem is overconsumption. Too many people consuming and consuming. So there are many fishing techniques that also destroy many ecosystems, and millions of tons of animals are discarded, including mammals, birds, turtles, invertebrates, etc. Luckily, there is some success stories around the world that we should learn from and to imitate. One example here in Mexico is called Cabo Pulmo. And Cabo Pulmo, it's a it's like paradise in South Baja California in Mexico. And it's a small fisherman town, or used to be a fisherman town that, I don't know, something like about 15, 20 years ago, they realized, the fishermen themselves, they realized that they had no future. You know, they knew that they were not catching enough even for their own sustenance, and they got worried for their children, what we're gonna do in the future. So they boldly decided to stop fishing by themselves. Nobody, you know, need to tell them or, you know, pressure them. They stopped, and they went to the government and asked, you know, to create a national marine protected marine park. And that's what they did. No, so now it's a super success story that many conservationists use around the world, because the biomass has come more than 400% than in those days, and many species that didn't saw them anymore for many, many years, they are returning to that place, and now life is booming over there. So it's a fantastic example. Another problem in the ocean is that more than 50% of the world's corals have disappeared. Only in 2015, we lost 30% of the corals in the world. In some areas of the Caribbean, up to 80%. This is a big, big, big problem, and it's a tragedy. Just think about it. just for a second, I might say it as a figure, no, it's just a number, but these are structures that took nature millions of years to create, you know. They are very, very slow on the rate of growth. So that just in 1 year we lost more than 30%, and that we are continuously losing and losing more is something to be alarmed. Now, we also throw more than 8 million tons of plastic every year. It never decomposes and stays there forever. In 2050, all the predictions say that there's going to be more plastic than fish in the ocean, and it impacts all the ecosystem and kills millions and millions of animals. These are some examples. You're going to see now some examples of how deadly the plastic actually is. Very graphic and very hard to see images. But it's important that we understand and that we see them. When I see like the picture you are looking right now, and I see there's so much plastic in this bird, in the stomach of the bird, I don't tend to, you know, try to blame others. Like if I see that picture, you know, I think, wow, I've used many plastic in my life. And even though I know I don't throw it, you know, in the street or in the ocean, but even though I throw it in garbage, the garbage distribution and solution might not always be the best one. And I know a lot of the garbage, for example, that it's been thrown in Mexico City ends up in the Pacific, in the Mexican Pacific. So I, when I see these kind of pictures, I ask myself, maybe it's one of the plastic that I have used that killed that animal, you know? So I try to be responsible of my own actions and not blaming others. So this is another very impacting picture. This one I took myself, and the girl you see on the back, she's a friend of mine, and she's doing this very valuable work also in La Paz, in Southeast, in South Baja California, in Mexico. And this sea lion was entangled with one of our plastics, and luckily, you know, they managed to save it, disentangle it, and now she was ready to go back to the ocean. But the worst thing of the problem of the plastic in the ocean is not the one that is in the surface, you know, and that it's a big one. The problem is that it's been floating there for many years, that a lot of it has crumbled into smaller and smaller and smaller pieces, up to the point that in 2015, scientists, for the first time, capture video of this microalgae, this microanimal that you can see in the picture, feeding itself from our plastic, microplastic. And this animal that you see, it's the one that produces more than half of the oxygen in the planet that we breathe. Well, not only one, there are millions and millions and millions. And when they come to the surface, because they tend to live in the deep in the ocean where it's very cold, and when they move up by the streams, they come to the surface, and when they hit the sunlight, they start a photosynthesis reaction, and when they hit the surface, they release oxygen, and they are actually feeding on our microplastic, which is very, very worrisome. Also, there are more than 400 dead zones in the ocean, and they reflect the changes in the chemistry of the ocean, excess of nutrients, fertilizers, and warming waters. These dead zones, they are distributed all over the world, and they are increasing by number very, very quickly. Also, global warming, of course, it's another of the big problems, and other changes in the climate that affect life and the oceanic systems. And in turn, this affects the atmosphere and the land systems. So pH is changing due to the excess of CO2 that we are thrown in the atmosphere, and it's been absorbed by the ocean. pH is very important. We, in our bodies, we also have a certain pH, and we can only live in a certain limit, okay, of pH. Same in the ocean, same the animals in the oceans. If the ocean gets too acidic, we will have a lot of problems, okay? And that's where we are heading. Okay, that's more or less the problems that we are creating. And I can tell you firsthand, I've traveled all around the world taking these pictures, and I see a lot of the problems that I just talked about. Everywhere I go, doesn't matter where in the world, I talk to fishermen and they can barely find fish anymore. They struggle a lot. Also, there's always less fish where I go to dive, you know, always less and less. I've seen many devastated ecosystems all over the world. I see there is a place where I used to dive since I was a little kid, and I've been coming over and over and over to this same reef in the Mexican Pacific all my life. And in 2015, actually, I went diving there, and suddenly all the corals were white, and there were no fish, they were gone. And it was so sad, you know, to see this amazing and beautiful place that I've known for all my life. Suddenly, wow, it was dead, no more fish, you know. I started crying on the water, and it was also another wake-up call for me, you know, and say, what are you gonna do about this? You know, this is the reality we are living. As I told you also, I see all the sea lions who are entangled with a lot of our plastic or hooks, as you can see in the picture. We are doing a lot of bad to the animals. Anyway, there is plastic everywhere I go diving. There are floating abandoned long lines in many places, which are super dangerous because they are still containing the hooks, and there are, you know, a lot of animals are still trapped. 2014, I did a trip to the Arctic, and you can see very dramatically the change in temperature, global warming over there, because in the year I went, there was 40% less pack ice than in previous years. Also, I was invited to a certain place in Florida where they take care of turtles, and we were releasing a little turtle, just baby born turtles. And I was talking to the people in charge of studying the turtles over there, and they told me that in their new studies, 100% of all the turtles below 5 years of age, they were all filled with plastic in the stomachs. So very sad. So in summary, biodiversity is a finite resource that we are running out, and we are going to be left with nothing if nothing changes. We cannot allow the ocean to reach a tipping point of no return. So it doesn't matter where we live, we all depend on the health of the ocean, and we must act to prevent a terrible future. We must understand that our life is interconnected to all animals, and that our well-being is directly linked to the well-being of these animals. Okay, so that finalizes the second part of the presentation. And now I would like to proceed to the most important one. Okay, now we know, everybody who has listened to my presentation, at least now had a good understanding of the actual problems that we are creating. And so now we must change, because now our conscience is going higher, okay? Now we can see the problems. Before we didn't know. Now that we can see, we must take, we must seize that opportunity and to start taking actions. We must change, okay? Or we must transform our consciousness into daily actions. So one of the biggest problems I see today is our actual model of production and consumption. Today, the system that we are living is that there are a lot of companies, big companies, that are producing products, damaging the environment, and they put so much chemicals and so much bad stuff in these products that they are also damaging our own health, which is sad. Okay, but how is this system sustained? The only way this system can sustain is because we pay for that system. We are the ones who are buying the products of these companies that are destroying the planet while doing so. So now we become their allies. Now we are in favor of them, of what they are doing. You see the problem? Now why do we buy them all this stuff? I don't know. You know, they have invested billions and billions of dollars, you know, to put all kind of crazy ideas into our heads. And these crazy ideas are, if you don't have this product, or if you don't buy this thing, or if you don't have this brand new auto or whatever, you're a loser. And that's a big problem, you know, because we believe what they are telling us. We believe that if we don't have this house or this brand or this stuff, then we are nobody. We are not successful in life. And that's just crazy. Because the more stuff we buy, the more we are damaging the environment. You see this crazy system? So we should start to look for a new system. This system is where companies produce products without damaging the environment and without damaging our own health. That's a good system. And we need to start sustaining this system. How do we change from here to here? It's very simple. It's not that hard. It's just the flow of the money, of our own money. Because the thing is, we have a lot of power as individuals, and not a lot of people will tell you that. Majority of people will think, oh, but what can I do? There's so many problems and I'm only one person. My actions will, you know, they are not enough, you know, nobody will see that. And that's not the way we should think, because that is not true. We have a lot of power as individuals. And our biggest power that we have is in our money and in where we spend our money. That's an enormous power, okay? Because if we don't like what the companies are doing to this world, you know, to this life, to this beautiful planet that we have and that we live in, if we don't like the way they are destroying it, we should all just stop buying their products and start buying products from different companies, producers, local, okay? They have a lot of respect for life and for the environment, and that they don't produce their products, you know, damaging everything around them. They're very conscious. There are a lot of people that are doing this kind of products, food. So that's, for me, the greatest power we have and the greatest opportunity to solve our problems. We need to understand that we are very, very powerful. So this kind of products that I'm talking about, it's everything that we consume every day, our food, our cleaning products, okay? The way we wash ourselves, the way we dress, everything has an impact on the environment. So, can we put another one? So, for me, the most powerful question you can ask yourself is, every time we go to buy something, ask yourself, where does it come from? What impact does it have on the environment, me purchasing that product? Do I really need it? Or can I just, you know, not buy it? We don't really need all the stuff that we crazy buy, you know, and we get into debt in order to buy stuff. That's just crazy behavior. We don't need all those stuff to be happy, okay? And we could buy it, no problem. If by buying it, we wouldn't destroy the environment, okay, you know, we could buy whatever we want, but that's not the case. That's not the reality. The reality is that every single item produced needs a lot of resources from nature that we don't have. Okay, there is not enough resources in this planet to keep the consumption rate as the way we are doing it today. Okay, so, and yeah, of course, we need to slow down our consumption. We live in an area of rampant consumerism, and look where it has taken us. Okay, so I am not perfect, and I'm still struggling every day. For me, it has been a journey of discovery and self-change, because by the time I opened my eyes, I was like, wow, okay, now what I'm gonna do about it, you know? So I started to go day by day and step by step. And since then, I have eliminated most of the products from big corporations. I barely spent any money in any corporation, because I know how damaging they are to the environment. And it's hard, okay, to change in this model, because you're gonna have to sacrifice some of your commodities, and that's fine. We need to start acting like that, okay? Because now, in the name of our commodity, you know, we use so many products that we don't need, okay? Or that it's the most easy or convenient one, you know? But convenient for what? You know what I mean? For me, to be lazy, you know, instead of walking another extra mile or whatever to find an organic store, trust me, it's worth it. Worth it if you go that extra mile. And we also need to start reconnecting with nature. Understand that nature doesn't need us to survive, but we do need nature, and we are killing it, okay? So we need to reconnect the way we are, you know, positioning ourselves in this planet, because we used to think that we are the masters of the universe and that we can control everything and that we can do whatever we want without any consequences. Well, acting that way has led us to this place where we are today, which is not very positive in many ways, okay? So we need to understand that we are part of nature, that nature doesn't need us at all, okay? We need nature, so we need to start taking care of nature again, okay? We need to understand that the smallest bee is so important to our own life, okay? And the smallest insect can create such a powerful impact in our own lives. And everything around us, you know, has that amazing, amazing interconnection with us, okay? We are not separated from nature, even though we, you know, we might live in big cities, in the middle of, you know, of far away places from nature. And we might think, I don't want to go to nature, it's scary, full of bad animals, whatever, you know. That's okay, but if you don't want to go to be there, actually, it's okay. But we need to protect it and to care for it, understanding the importance to our own lives. One of the biggest problems we also have is that we are too many, and so there is a big debate on if we should, you know, how good or bad is to eat meat, for example. You know, that's another big problem that we have. And I know there are a lot of people who will not abandon their meat eating habits, you know, and they have a lot of way of thinking about it and defending it, and it's okay, I respect that. But my point of view on that is that whether you think that killing animals in the way we kill them and breeding them in the way we breed them, it's okay, which I don't, but the biggest problem is that they produce so many greenhouse effects, you know, and they and also feeding the animals that we actually eat takes up to 70% or 80% of all the world's crop, which is a big problem. And water scarcity has to do also with the, you know, with the, growing all these animals that we eat. In any case, it doesn't add up. Okay, there is not enough land for all the cattle that we'll need to feed all the world. So in any case, we lost our right to eat meat because the very bad way we have done it. And there is also no sustainable fishing today, okay? Don't get fooled by that. And why not? Because the problem is not overfishing, it's overconsumption. I know a lot of very small fishing communities in northern Mexico that they themselves, only themselves, in their small piece of ocean, they're doing things in a very good way, okay? They are very sustainable if you only look at the small picture. But themselves, they have had to, for example, buy guns and buy special boats to patrol their waters at night, because other fishermen who are not doing the things in a sustainable way, they cannot find fish outside this area, so they will come into that area, you know, with guns and, you know, so actually by consuming, we are actually also putting the life of a lot of people in the world, a lot of fishermen at risk, because the ones who are doing it in a sustainable way, you know, unfortunately, not everybody is doing it that way. So I think today there is no sustainable fishing. There is so much consumption that problems are just gonna pop up everywhere. We need to stop actually, and create new solutions. Also, well, plastic problem, which is the problem that I think it has been addressed most in the world, but we're still very far away to actually, you know, solving the problem. So please don't use single-use plastic anymore. Okay, this is very important items that we all need to start carrying in our daily lives, and stop using as much plastic as we can. Please also support ONGs. There are so many ONGs that are doing such a valuable work for the environment. NGOs. And also, if you can get involved in local projects, there's always going to be something local, you know, where you can put your hands, your voice, and your enthusiasm to help, to participate, support the creation of hot spots or national marine parks with full protection from fish. Whenever you see, you know, a petition or something, you know, regarding to protect our environment, please sign it. They do make a difference. Educate yourself. That's very, very important. You need to spend some time in your life, you know, aside from recreation and from sports and from learning, you know, all these kinds of things in school, which are also important. But we need to have the habit to educate ourselves to actually the biggest challenge that we have in our lifetimes, which is global change, you know, global warming and this climate crisis that we are going through in the planet. Please also stop going to dolphinariums. Watch documentaries like The Cove. The Cove is a very valuable documentary that opened our eyes to millions of people all over the world of the actual, you know, of the reality of what's going on in a dolphinarium. So if you don't believe me, just please watch the documentary The Cove, you know, and so you will see, you will have a broader perspective on what we are doing to these animals. Other documentaries as Plastic Ocean, Chasing Corals, Before the Flood, Racing Extinction, Earthlings. There are so much material and amazing people that have done amazing efforts, you know, to bring us so much awareness. Please just, you know, all that we need to do is just take the time and the effort to watch it and learn from it and grow our conscience. And from there, start to change. And in that way, we can get involved, we can raise our own awareness, we can inspire other people, and we can become agents of change. We must face our ego, where we have unconsciously take without giving anything in return. And it's time to give back to Earth. Stop fighting each other. We're also interconnected. Just look at any post on Facebook or any social media that's gonna be controversial, and start reading at the commentaries on the bottom. How we treat each other is also a sign of what we're going through inside. And it's not very nice, you know, what I see in many of these commentaries. We destroy each other, you know, we hate so much. That has to stop also, because that's creating a lot of noise, a lot of bad energy, you know? So be mindful on your words, on what you type, on how you address to another human being, you know. And it's also, well, finally, it's time to raise our awareness and translate it into our daily actions. And with that, I'm gonna end the presentation. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, now we're gonna start a Q&A session.
Yes, hi everyone. This is Katie Subra. Thank you so much, Christian Vizl, for your outstanding work and your great message today. I am going to share a couple of.
So I'm opening here a Q&A. There is one question.
Yep.
It says, so Christian, I appreciate your presentation on both your work and your message for conservation of the ocean. of the environment of the world. Which came first for you, photography or conservation, or did they develop and deepen simultaneously? Actually, it was first photography and then conservation, because when I started taking pictures on the water, you know, I started to spend most of my time in the ocean. And then I started to ask myself, I started to learn, to educate myself. There was a period of about 2 years where I saw every single documentary there was about it. I learned all the books, you know, all the science about it. And I got very depressed, to be honest. And I got very depressed for a little while, but then I understood that that's not the way to be, you know? That's not gonna help anybody, and especially me, you know? And that's not the way to live my life. It has no sense, okay? So I immediately changed, and then I said, well, what can I do, you know? And the first thing that I realized, it was that the most important thing is to start with me and with my own actions, because I cannot come and talk to people, you know, and tell them, hey, you change, if I haven't changed, you know, that just doesn't make sense. So first I changed myself and I changed my ways, and I especially changed everything now that I buy, you know, where I buy it, where I spend my money. Now it's a big, big focus for me. So conservation was last, yes, but it's gonna be, it actually has been a great gift in my life, because it gives a lot of meaning and a lot of intention to my work. Before I was just a photographer, now I'm a photographer with an intention and with a message, okay? Did you take all pictures while scuba diving? That's another question from Yoyati Devnath. No, actually a lot of the pictures are taken while snorkeling. A lot of animals love to spend time in the surface, and no need to scuba dive for them. Sophia Gem, hi Christian, beautiful message and photography. On the photography side of things, what resources did you turn to learn and grow into the renowned photographer you are today? What resource did you turn to? Oh, that's a very profound and very good question. It will take me a lot of time to explain that. And I also like to talk about that, because that's like, I think that's to talk about what's really important in photography, but it will deviate us a lot from the theme. But to give you a quick answer, a lot of people, or a majority of people, think that in photography, what's most important is your technique and your camera, you know? And I don't agree with that. I think, you know, to create amazing images, of course you need to know about technique and about your camera and all that, but the most important thing is all the connection you have with your values, with your emotions, with the way you see the world. Everything that you see around and that you absorb, you know, has an impact on the click that you are gonna do to take that picture, you know? So that's what I take care a lot. What I, you know, everything that I see and everything that I perceive has an impact on creating my images. So I actually turn to any resource that I can. I read, I know I like to see all kinds of movies, but not only, you know, movies that inspire me or movies that, you know, that gives me a different perspective. I love to art, to see art in any form that I can, because it also inspires me. I see the work of others and in different areas, not only in wildlife photography. So it's a hopefully one day I will have more time to talk about that. How did you clean them up to keep the subject so clear? It's a question of your, I think, meaning that my images are very clean. I think that it's the way I perceive them, okay? It's the way I see them, because I only wait for the moment until the animal is out of a lot of things that create a lot of noise in my head or in my vision of a photography. So if you see a shark, you know, I only like to have the silhouette of the shark, because that's so much beauty, you know, it's so much going on in just the silhouette of the shark. I find so much beauty in some, you know, it's just the natural design of the animals that I find so amazing. No need to know, you know, about many other elements, you know, about corals, whatever, in that particular picture, because I like that simplicity, and I like that because it's a way of understanding nature or the beauty as the way I see it, you know, very simple. There are so many questions. Thank you very much. I am a 9-year-old and want to be an underwater photographer one day. What advice do you have? Well, I'm really thrilled that you want to be an underwater photographer. The best advice maybe I can give you is to enjoy it. If this, you know, whatever you do in your life, it's the most important thing is that you enjoy it. Enjoy doing it, because if you actually love what you do, you're going to be very good at it, because you're going to do it a lot. And if you are actually very good at it, then you're going to be able to make a living out of it, because, you know, money is just going to come alone. You don't need to look for money. If you do something valuable for the rest or for others, then the money is going to come. Okay. So don't focus your goal on making money. Focus on what's really important to you, what you really enjoy doing in your life. And if it's underwater photography, then go ahead and start with diving. Start with love to the ocean, okay? Start with love and respect. Develop that in yourself, okay? Learn about the animals. Learn about their behavior, about their problems, about their struggles. Because in that way, you're going to respect them, okay? That's the basic thing to go underwater. We need to learn to be there with respect. Because we share this beautiful and amazing planet with so much life, such a variety of life, that they have their own senses and perceptions. We don't know who they are. You know? They are different from us in many ways, but we do share a lot. We share life. We are alive. And so start from there, from having this love for all life, okay, especially in the ocean. How does being underwater allow you to see the world differently? Well, I don't know if I see the world differently, or I don't know how other people see the world, but I do know that I learn a lot from the animals, and that helps me a lot in my vision of the world. For example, if I see two whales, a humpback whale and a calf, I see so much unconditional love, unconditional love. And the way they treat each other is amazing, and so much tenderness and so much love in their interactions, you know, it's amazing. Or if I see a pod of dolphins, wow, they are so smart and so intelligent. And I know that they talk to themselves by name, and they live in groups of families, and they interact, and they live all their lives together. And for example, all the animals, this is something that I've learned from them. They are born and they are equipped with everything they need to be what they are. And they just experience themselves as they are. You know, they don't need to be something else. They don't want to be someone else. You know, they just experience the magic of being alive and the magic of being a dolphin or being a sea lion. I don't see that a lot in humans. We should, okay? We don't need a lot of stuff to be happy and enjoy life. We have everything we need already, okay, to be enjoying and to be having our life, living it fully. We don't need to do anything, just live. It says, I collaborate with Sylvia Earl on my recent book, Silent Kingdom. In the documentary Mission Blue, Dr. Earl says that she does not eat fish herself. Should we follow her example? Definitely, yes. And the thing is, don't follow, you know, don't do things just because, you know, somebody else is telling you. Try to find a very good reason on why you are doing whatever you are doing. So I also don't eat fish, and I think it's a very good idea not to eat fish. There are thousands of different reasons why we shouldn't be eating fish, but you have to find your own reason that is going to be strong enough, okay? One of them, one reason that I think it can resonate with all of us is the simple fact that we are emptying the oceans. We are killing them too fast, okay, and too many. That they are, we are not giving time for them to recover, okay? So we need to stop, otherwise we're gonna empty the ocean. And emptying the ocean from life, you might say, well, I don't care. I know I don't go to the ocean. I don't like it. It's a scary place, you know, there are sharks, whatever. We must not think like that, because we need to understand that that's not the reality. The reality is we need fish, okay? We need sharks to be in the ocean. We need them alive, and we need their ecosystems vibrant and healthy, because otherwise, if they are gone, we are gone, okay? Deborah C., you talk about the impact of your parents on your ways of being in the world. What suggestions would you give to parents and teachers? How about to engage children to pay attention to, express their concerns about, and take action to take care of the earth that is our home and all the creatures that live here? Definitely, Deborah, I agree with you. The key for the future is in educating our children. That's it. I have no doubt about that. I talk all my life is it's always talking about these items, even among my family, you know, about the things that I talk to you about, you know, about ocean conservation, about the way we see nature, you know. I'm always talking about this. And what I found is that it's very, very hard for older people, you know, as older as we get, it's harder for them, you know, to change or to understand. It's a little bit frustrating. But when you talk to kids and children, you know, they're instantly, they get it. They understand right away, you know, and you can see their enthusiasm, you know, when you present them with an alternative, you know, say, okay, you have the alternative to buy this stuff, but this is the consequences. How about buying this, you know? And they are like, oh yeah, of course. They don't, you know, they don't have these mental creations, you know, stick so, I don't know, so hard as we adults have, you know? And so, yeah, we and of course we need to start educating our children, in my opinion, today, because every stage in human history has had its own retos, their own struggles. And you know, my father was born in the Second World War, you know, and blah blah blah. Or 500 years ago, if you were a woman and you know, talk about freely about something, you might get burned, you know, only because of somebody's ideology. And so throughout history, we have to face different retos. We have to face different challenges, okay? And in my opinion, this is the most important challenge we have in our lives, is to find a solution or the solutions for the climate change, okay? So for me, that would be the key to start teaching kids, okay? But okay, if you add, okay, that in order to find all these solutions, we also need to start raising kids in a more, with more ethics, with more values, okay? Very strong values, very strong ethics, because that is the basic of consciousness. And I think that's the problem we have. We have a problem of lack of consciousness. That is the problem that we have today in humanity. But if we will raise our consciousness, we will definitely have different values and act in a very, very different way. So yes, I think the most important and most valuable education starts at home. So Susie Charlau says, if we want to promote conservation through photography, what is the best, most effective way to get the message out? That is a good question. I ask myself so many times, when I opened my eyes, you know, after 2 years of watching the documentaries, and I thought, what can I do? I actually, at some point, I thought, okay, I'm gonna give up taking underwater pictures and I'm gonna become an activist and I'm gonna join Sea Shepherd because I admired these guys a lot. And, but then almost, I almost did that. But then I thought, well, wait a second, you know, if my talent is to reach people, you know, through my photography, well, why not reach it, you know, in such a way as to inspire people to take care of the animals, you know? I thought a different way, and that's how my photography with intention started, you know, because I found some value in that. And because, you know, that's what I know how to do it. I know I was born with this talent, you know, to create pictures that people like. And then I thought, well, better stick to that and use it into the... So the most effective way to get the message, I think it's a combination. I don't think there is one way, because, for example, I took the decision to only portray beautiful pictures without any problems. But that is a personal choice. And why I took it is because there are so many images, some of them I show you today, that are very hard to see, you know, of animals with plastic in their stomachs or blah, blah, blah. And there's nothing wrong with those images. I'm actually very thankful that they are around there and that we have, majority of people, we have all seen them. But I think the problem is that if the only images that we show are bad and terrible, you know, then people are going to start to create a barrier and say, I don't want to see this anymore. You know, there's so much I can take. So I think there needs to be a balance between these hard to see pictures and beautiful pictures, because beautiful pictures can get the same result, but through a different way, which is through our emotions, you know, our most sensible part, human part, which is our emotions. And so I think love is also a very powerful thing that we have in the world. And I think there's so much, and beauty is just a manifestation of this love. So actually what I'm, my picture, I think they're all about love. You know, I see so much beauty, but the beauty is love. You know? It's an expression of love. And I think if we will open, every one of us will open to love, you know, to beauty, we will all be, you know, like living our lives like, wow, you know, that's the power that love has. But we need to open ourselves, you know, to be able to absorb it, to, you know, to realize that everywhere you look, there's going to be beauty. Come on. Okay, there's another question by René Stowell. What organizations do you see doing valuable work for the oceans? Definitely Sea Shepherd. Wow, I really admire these guys. I've seen them in action, and they not about talk, they're about actions. And I think today, that's the most important thing, because we're running out of time. There is not a lot of time, okay? And we need action. Mission Blue, of course, Mission Blue by Sylvia Earle. And they're inspiring, and they are doing this great, great, great movement around the world. And their message is that we need the creation of hope spots, which is a fantastic idea. That's to protect certain very, very special places all around the ocean. Where life can thrive. And in addition to the power I have as an individual to change my own habits, I'm interested in supporting organizations that can have a bigger impact than just me. Well, thank you, Renee, for thinking that way. That's very inspiring for me and for, I hope, everybody. And I think that's the best way to go, you know? First change us, and then start taking actions outside. That's the way to go. I don't know how much time left do we have?
We have about 5 more minutes before a wrap-up message. There's a couple more questions unanswered here. Joyati is asking if you take a lot of pictures at a moment and then choose one later that fits your mind.
A ver. ¿Quién? Ah, okay, so there's another question. Yoyati Debnath. So you take a lot of pictures at the moment and then choose the one that fits your mind? Well, Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit more complicated, the process, because what I actually do is when I go in the ocean, I don't start taking pictures of them right away. No. I first, you know, actually sometimes I prepare myself a lot. I haven't done that in a while, but there was a time where I was doing that every time, and I actually see changes, and it actually worked. I was meditating before the dive, and I was asking permission, you know, to the ocean and the animals for me to get in, for them to accept me. I don't know if they did. I never heard an answer, but spiritually I did, and I hope they welcome me. And then I like to go down first and just observe, just admire, you know, whatever is going on. To open myself up to the beauty that I'm going to watch and that it's all around me. That's the most important part, actually, of what I do, to enjoy it, you know. And then later, you know, I start to see the angles for photography. That comes later, you know. First, I absorb, where is beauty, you know. And then beauty can be created, you know, just arise in so many different forms. And then, you know, and suddenly you see a light of ray that it's, you know, coming this way and an angle, and it's, you know, or you see shadows, or you see contrast, or you see shapes or forms. And then, you know, eventually, I see a picture, you know, in my mind and over there. And then I start taking pictures. But that's a little bit of the process.
I see a great question that I'm sure a lot
there of people... There is another question. Says, don't you need a lot of oxygen to take with you to sit there and watch the beauty? You're always limited by diving, all the diving rules, and I respect them all, and you only have the time you have, and so I plan my dive accordingly, and usually for the first 5-10 minutes I won't usually take any pictures, because unless something really special happened, and then, you know, you check it. But otherwise, I like to first, you know, be calm and observe. And
so Antoinette Dreyer would like to know what your favorite location or subject is.
My favorite dive location. Well, that's also very hard to answer, because I had so many. I like all the animals, to be honest. Not only the big one and impressive one and the sharks and this and that. No, I also love the small ones, all animals, the invertebrates, all of them. So the thing is, in every place you go, you will find different variety of animals or species, but I think my favorite area to go is Baja California in Mexico. I think that's a very, very special place, and in a relatively small area you can find so many places to go with different animals, like sea lions, like sharks, fish, the biggest school of fish we have in Mexico and many parts of the world, which are in Cabo Pulmo, the protected area that I was talking about earlier. So that area would be my favorite location. And now I see, do you see a distinction between your black and white and color images? Do you see one type as an art photo and one as a documentary photo? There can be art also in color, but in my own photography, I think I'm not very good in color, or not as good as black and white, because my mind is naturally trained. I was born like this. The first, when I started to take photography, was film, and I admire a lot Ansel Adams, his beautiful landscapes in black and white, and I was very attracted to black and white photography, even, you know, when I was a kid. And so my first roles, they were black and white. Black and white photography, you need to see your scene in black and white. we see in color, but you need to imagine, you know, in black and white, what will work. You know, it has a thing to do black and white photography, and I just like it more. And Robert asking me, how have I seen underwater artists that the Minnesota Maritime Art Museum featured this year? Dogs and then ethereal views of people in beautiful forms. To be honest, I haven't seen it. I feel bad about not seeing my previous co-exhibitionist, but I will, promise. And Deborah, I appreciate me saying that I spend time observing and paying attention. Simon Weil said, attention is the rarest and purest form of generosity. Yes, yes, if you get attention from people, of course, they are being very generous, and you people are being very generous to me. You have spent, you know, I'm only talking by myself, and you are very, very generous to be, you know, listening at what I have to say. So thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. A big thank you to Christian Vizl again for this presentation today.
I think the questions, I don't see any more questions, so.
Yep, I think we're done with the Q&A portion.
We're done.
Yep. We really appreciate your time and your beautiful artwork and your message. So to all of the attendees out there, just a couple quick reminders. You can check out more of Christian's work through the Marine Art Museum. And of course, please connect with the theme events and notes on the website links in the chat there. And a big thank you to everyone involved with promoting this event today and getting it together. So I hope you will have a beautiful weekend. And
sorry,
Oh, you're muted.
Yes.
Okay.
Now I can hear you. The thing is, my volume was low. Sorry.
No problem. I'll make one last note is that we've got this recorded today, so we will share this with our community, both through the Marine Art Museum and through the theme. So thanks again, Christian, for your wonderful presentation and your great message.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Katie.
That was great. Thanks, Christian.
I'm just, so was it good? You like it?
Yeah, it was great. I think people had a lot of good questions, which means they're engaged and they wanted to know more.
Yes, they were very good questions.